RetroArch is an amazing program that compiles just about every popular emulator, or core, from all of your favorite systems into one organized headend where you can access all of your ROMs. This makes navigating through all of your game files super easy and streamlined, and it even shows box art. It is extremely convenient having all of this in one place and being able to save controller profiles, individual ROM settings, organize save files and save states, hotkeys, and more. Not to mention, it removes the hassle of having to micromanage multiple emulator programs and remap controllers constantly just to play your favorite old school games. If you have not used this program before, I highly recommend it. It is available now on a ton of platforms, including Windows, Mac, Linux, Raspberry Pi, Android, iOS, Steam, PlayStation consoles, Xbox consoles, Nintendo Switch, and heck, maybe even your toaster. The scope of this video will be for the PC, but a lot of the information is likely useful for other platforms too. I'm just going to cover the basics, like how to add different cores, create playlists for your games, and download box art. I figured an up-to-date tutorial showing how I personally like to set up RetroArch might be of use to some of you. On top of that, I have a couple of tips and tricks videos in the works, and realized I should probably have a startup guide to reference before I get into anything else. But do keep an eye on the channel in the coming days for more on RetroArch. Anyway, let's hop right in. Alright, I will try to keep this as brief as possible while still giving you all the information that I think you need to get started. First, I want you to go ahead and create a folder on your desktop called RA Stuff, which just stands for RetroArch Stuff, or you can really call it whatever you want. Inside, we're going to create two subfolders called ROMs, where we can put our game files, and RetroArch, and that one needs to be spelled correctly. Now look in the important links in the video description down below. The first link there is going to bring you to the RetroArch download page. Just grab the stable version here, as the nightly version may not be tested as much. Once that's downloaded, just run the .exe installer. I am going to install mine where I made that folder on the desktop there, which is desktop RA stuff, and right here RetroArch. Wherever you install it, it does need to have RetroArch as the name, and I believe it needs to be empty as well. Right here, go ahead and check DirectX to install DirectX 9. If you already have it, it's okay. Just check it anyway to be sure that you do have it. It will not hurt if you already have it and you install over it. I'm going to speed this up real quick. Go ahead and accept the agreement for DirectX. Be careful right here. I do not want to install this Bing bar, so uncheck that. Hit next, and then go ahead and finish out. You'll see that RetroArch creates a desktop shortcut here. I'm going to put mine in the folder, the RA stuff folder, just so I keep everything nice and contained. Now launch RetroArch, and you'll be greeted by this screen here. I know this looks a little intimidating, but I promise it's not as bad as it looks. And actually, the first thing we're going to do is make it look a lot better. So click on Settings over here, scroll down just a little bit until you see User Interface, click on that. And right here where it says Menu Ozone, click on that. And then change this to XMB, click on that. Once that's XMB, just exit out, and then we're gonna pull it right back up. And voila, we have this beautiful XMB that looks a lot like the old PlayStation 3 menu. Go ahead and hit F on your keyboard to go to full screen. And I'll mention that RetroArch actually has a very good controller support. You might've seen in the bottom there where it said DualShock 4 controller. That's because I'm using a DualShock 4 and it's already recognizing it. If you're using like a PS3, PS4, PS5, Xbox 360, Xbox One, Xbox Series, Switch Pro, most of those first-party controllers, all of them should work right out the get-go. And that's for both plug-and-play and for Bluetooth and play. I actually, in addition to this PS4, I have an Xbox Series X, or S maybe, the newest one. I have a Switch Pro, and I have this third-party 8-bit Duo SN30 Pro, which is actually really nice. All four of these, I tried them before this video, all four of them worked perfectly right away with both plug-and-play and Bluetooth-and-play. So you really shouldn't have a problem with controllers. In the future, I may make a separate video going over issues, common issues with controllers in RetroArch, but that's for another day. So now we're gonna go ahead and get some games in here, right? Well, before we do that, we need to add cores to our library. which basically means that we're adding the emulators for whatever platforms or consoles that we want to play. Sometimes there are multiple cores for the same console, so it can be hard to choose, and a lot of times choosing any of them will work, but I'm going to list some of the cores that I personally use down in the video description, so check there. Today, I'm going to be using NES, the Nintendo Entertainment System, and the PlayStation 1 consoles as examples. So that means we need to get an NES and PS1 core. Well, go ahead and we're going to go over here to the online updater. And then core downloader is the first option there. And we're going to find NES, Nintendo NES Famicom, which is, let's see, right here. You'll see that there are a few different cores. There are four. One, it's right here. I'm going to go with Nestopia. I've used that before. I know that's a good one. So go ahead and select that one. Now we need the PlayStation 1. It's under Sony. PlayStation right there. Again, I see a few different ones. I'm picking this PCSX ReARMed. I've used that before and had great success. So I'm going to select that one. Now, PlayStation 1 actually requires one additional step. Certain consoles in their cores need a BIOS, which is basically like a set of computer instructions that enables the software to run. PlayStation 2, Sega CD, Sega Saturn, Dreamcast, and some others, they also need a BIOS. But, you know, this is why I chose PS1 as an example, so I can show you how to do this. It can be a little tricky, and some people do mess this up. Anyway, I'm gonna hit F again to go to small screen here. And look down in the second link in the important link section, and it's going to take you to the main BIOS page here. And what we want is BIOS for PlayStation. So click on that and click on the files here. Go ahead and download this file. Once you have it downloaded, run the zip file. You will of course need WinRAR or 7-zip to run it. Open it up. Now, these are different packs of BIOS, and this one right here, UC stands for United States Canada, I believe. This is J for Japan, E for Europe. I'm just going to use these right here because I know they work and that's where I'm located. So we're going to open these up and we're going to put these files in a specific spot where RetroArch was installed. I know mine was right here installed on the desktop in this RetroArch folder. There are all the files it installed. Just come right here to the system. And we're going to drag all these files right in there. Now, depending on where you get your BIOS, if you say you don't get it from this website, you need to make sure that it's in the correct lowercase and in the correct format, because it is very picky about that. So I need to be in lowercase here. But if you look at the README, it actually mentions that I need to rename a file. You'll see for RetroArch right here as well. This is the one for Japan, the one for America, and the one for Europe right here. So this is the one that I'm concerned with. Now, if you look, this ps30a.bin right here needs to be renamed to this. So let's go ahead and just do that. Be careful here because this needs to be done correctly. So just click again in order to rename. Make sure it's lowercase scph5501.bin. Make sure that's still there. It is perfect. If you don't get this right, PlayStation 1 games likely will not work, or whatever BIOS you're trying to do. Just Google what BIOS the format needs to be for that specific core. But this is how it needs to be for the PS1. So I'm going to just exit out. All right, now I'm going to go ahead and link a few of my favorite ROM sites down in the video description as well. I know that VimsLayer and ROMs Pure CC are both pretty good sites. But once you have compiled some games or obtained like a ROM set file, we're ready to go ahead and scan for them. So let me just show you. These are the two folders that I'm using today as an example. Here they are again, the NES and the PSX. If you take a look here, the NES files are a .NES format, while the PSX files are like in a folder and they have like a .bin and a .q. Doesn't really matter. I'm just showing you that ROMs are in all kinds of different formats, so you'll have to watch out and not just, you know, expect them all to look the same. Once again, I'm just going to put everything in the same folder here. So we're going to move these to the ROMs folder that I made on the desktop. So that way we know where it is. We're going to come back into RetroArch here, and I'm going to move over to where this plus is and go to scan directory, which is the first one selected. We know mine is on the desktop, which is under C. And then I went up to go all the way down to the bottom to go to users, select your username, and then desktop. Again, it's RA stuff. ROMs, and there are the two ROM file folders that I have. So we're gonna scan both of them. NES, scan this directory, and then we're gonna go to PSX, scan this directory, and we'll see down there that it's complete. It'll take a little longer if you have a big, long, like, library of NES games or something. Back all the way out. And now we'll see that there are two brand new icons right there. NES and PlayStation. Perfect. It looks like it grabbed everything that I had there. No missing ones. That's great. So we need to go ahead and get that box art for it, right? Let's come right over here all the way to the left again. And we're going to go to Online Updater once again. But this time we're going to the Playlist Thumbnails Updater. Select that. We're going to run it for the PlayStation, and we're going to run it for the NES. Now, once again, if you have a long list, this could take a few minutes. That's totally normal. So I'm going to back out and take a look here. Oh, yes, that looks beautiful. Look at those. Perfect. It updated all the box arts. Now, if you're missing a box art or like a thumbnail for whatever reason, there could be a couple different things going on. I'm going to create a separate video explaining how to fix that. It is a little more involved than I want to go into in this video, so I'll get to that in a separate vid. Right now, though, one more thing we need to do. If you come back over to the far left again and click on Show Desktop Menu, it's going to bring up this separate submenu, which is basically the same menu. It's just showing it in a different format, which might be a little bit easier to edit. But just come over here and right-click on your Nintendo, associate the core with Nestopia, and do it with the PlayStation, associate core with PCSX ReARMed. What that does is make it so that when you play a game, it automatically associates that core, and you don't have to select it. Every time you select a new game, it's just automatic. You hit run, and the game comes up. So just exit right out of that. We're good to go on that. And I am going to hit full screen again. And go ahead and test out a game just to show you that it should indeed work. So let's run Grand Theft Auto 2 and run it. Now, as this is coming up here, I'm just gonna go ahead and hit the home button right here, and it brings up the in-game menu. Now in this menu, you can do a few things. You can like save the state, load it, you can add like cheats, you can change the control layout, you can close out the game or start a new game, all by going back to the menu here. While we're in here, I highly recommend doing this if you're on PlayStation 1 in particular. Go into Controls, down to Port 1 Controls, because that's what we're on. In the very first line there, Device Type, change Standard down to DualShock, and that will allow you to use the two sticks for most of the PlayStation games that you otherwise wouldn't be able to do. So in this screen right here, just save game remap file. That way, every time you come into this particular game, that DualShock will already be enabled and you don't have to do it each time. And now I'm going to go ahead and, before I resume, go to 4x3 since that's the format that PlayStation is in, and hit resume. Now I'm going to turn down the volume by hitting the minus sign on the numpad because I'm sure it's going to be loud. Plus and minus on the numpad, change the volume there. All right. I think that about covers it for the scope of this video, now that it looks like this is definitely working. Do stay tuned to the channel in the coming weeks and days. I will be going over more RetroArch tutorials, in particular how to fix that thumbnail if you have missing thumbnails for the box art, and also what to do if you have like multiple disc games, such as Final Fantasy VII or Metal Gear Solid, and how to get your save files working with that. But for this particular video, it looks like everything is working smoothly here. So I hope that you got everything up and running on your end. And I do hope that you have a wonderful rest of your day. Bye-bye.